Welcome. Grab your favorite morning beverage and join us for Morning Cannolis with Jim Santel.
You don't know me, but I'm your brother.
Sampling the news desserts of the week, here is your host, Jim Santel.
Good morning. This is Jim Santel. Welcome to all of you to Morning Cannolis, sampling the news desserts of the week. This is, as always, a weekend review of the important stories in law, in government, and the aspiration for justice in America. Thank you so much for spending some portion of your Saturday morning with me, talking about those issues important to America today, in the future, and also in the past. We've got a very special syllabus today. We'll be spending a lot of time talking about things going on in our courts, very much consistent with our mission, our goals here at Morning Cannolis, to talk about the aspiration for justice in America. I'll tell you more about that specific agenda, that syllabus, in just a few minutes. We're coming to you this morning, as always, from the studios here in WAUK, the Shaw in downtown Waukesha. That's 540 AM, 101 FM. I'm delighted, as always, to have my producer, Calvin, with me, who throughout the morning, this hour and next hour, too, will be talking with all of us, will be working with me and bringing your calls in at 844-967-2789. Calvin, my producer, working with you to ensure that you've got an opportunity as well to make comments, offer questions, and provide perspectives on the important issues that we are chatting about this morning. This is our 13th show in the series that began way back in June, very, very shortly. On the website of WAUK Radio here in Waukesha, you'll be able to get access to all of those prior shows, including this one, if you happen to miss it. And as you well know, this show also broadcasts again tomorrow morning, every Sunday morning, in the same setting for 2 hours, Morning Cannolis here on WAUK. Again, taking your calls throughout the morning, this hour and next hour at 844-967-2789. Thank you so much for joining me. As always, we begin with some recollections, some references back in history to things that happened on this day in history. Today, it is the 253rd day of 2022. We have 112 days left to go. A number of different and important things in the history of our world, of our nation, happened on September 10th. In history, in 1509, a massive earthquake known as the Lesser Judgment Day hit Constantinople, killing many, many people, huge destruction, and one of the major events of the early 16th century. 1509, that earthquake happening in Constantinople. On 1608, September 10th, 1608, John Smith became the council president of the Jamestown Colony, the first permanent English settlement in North America, as you all well know from your history studies in grade school and in high school, perhaps in college and beyond. You may recall as well that according to most accounts, he survived capture by some of our first Native Americans through the intervention of Pocahontas. And John Smith in 1608 on this date, September 10th, becoming the first council president of the Jamestown Colony, and also affirming again a strong tie with the Native Americans in that area in Jamestown Colony back in 1608. 1812, during the War of 1812, Commander Oliver Hazard Perry, part of the U.S. Navy, defeated the British in the Battle of Lake Erie, 1812, a decisive battle, a decisive military move during the course of that all-important war following on the heels of our own Revolutionary War. 1846, a number of years later, the American inventor Elias Howe, H-O-W-E, was granted a patent for what? The sewing machine that revolutionized in many ways the garment manufacturing industry and factories and homes throughout America, across the planet. 1846, a patent granted to Elias Howe for the sewing machine. In 1960, at the Summer Olympics in Rome, a very significant event in the history of sports,
in our world. Abdi Bikila became the first sub-Saharan African to win the gold medal. He won the marathon running that in bare feet. Abdi Bikila becoming the first sub-Saharan African to win a gold medal on that day, September 10th, 1960, at the Summer Olympics in Rome. And on 1998 at the U.S. Open, Steffi Graf, remember her, Steffi Graf, this great tennis player, completed the Grand Slam of tennis on that day by winning the U.S. Open 1998 on September 10th. She was the first woman to accomplish that since Margaret Court had done the same thing way back in 1970. And finally, in 2017, Hurricane Irma, Hurricane Irma made landfall in the Florida Keys, a Category 4 hurricane, catastrophic impact upon the Caribbean just before that. And in that area and in the Florida Keys, 134 deaths, $65 billion in damages, 2017, September 10th. 2017, Hurricane Irma still having an impact to this day in that part of the world. As I indicated, this morning we're going to revisit our fundamental notion, our fundamental mission here, our purpose on Morning Cannolis, and talk a lot about justice in America. We're going to talk a lot about courts, special syllabus on what courts do, how they act, and as always, always relying upon and invoking some of the major news stories of the week, and an awful lot of stories this morning that you probably did not hear about, things that have fallen under the radar this past week that are equally important to understanding what we do in America when it comes to the rule of law and the enforcement of the law and the aspiration for justice in all of our courts. I'm going to talk a lot about what happened in our courts this past week. Again, some major cases, some major files that are moving towards some disposition, and then also a lot of things in the criminal setting, the civil setting as well, some settlements, some plea agreements, some dispositions, some jury trials underway in our courts here in America. Along the way, we talk about the purpose of courts. Why do we have courts in America? Why do we have courts in virtually every civilized nation on the face of the planet? We know well that there are different historical and contemporary traditions when it comes to the ways in which administration of justice is undertaken. Spent a lot of time in Iraq and overseas in the Middle East, and a very different system there that was very, very court-centered, very much judge-centered. In our nation and in other places around the globe, an awful lot of checks and balances involving prosecutors and the important roles of defense attorneys and victim witness specialists, and yes, judges and witnesses, certainly, grand juries, trial juries, appellate courts at all levels to review the activities and the actions of lower courts. All of these things a part of our judicial system that also animates some of the news items we're going to be talking about this morning in the 9 o'clock hour, and then also going into the 10 o'clock hour, always taking your phone calls at 844-967-2789. So why do we have courts? Why do we have these things called tribunals of justice? Well, we know, as we have seen in many stories in the past, that fundamentally they're there to resolve disputes, right? Civil and criminal disagreements between parties, could be individuals, could be corporations, often is. Resolving disputes in civil and criminal cases, people who have not been able to resolve those disputes outside of tribunals. And what does that promote? What kinds of things does that advance? Well, it does all kinds of things. It promotes education, right? The arts, healthcare, transportation, commerce, business. Very important for business people to know that if they have disputes in contracts, other things, they can go into the courts and get those disputes resolved. The resolution of disputes, civil and criminal, very important. A fundamental notion, a fundamental purpose of our courts in America and throughout the globe. Certainly, courts promote safety and security, right? A key part of our law enforcement regime. taking care that the law is not only enforced, but that it has a sense of justice sent to the community as well. Taking care of the victim survivors of crime, ensuring that their rights, as we're going to hear in at least one of the stories today, that their rights are not only taken in account, but they're also a part of the judgments that are entered in civil courts, in criminal courts especially, when it comes to the imposition of fines and restitution and other ways in which victims perhaps can't be made whole, but nonetheless can be taken care of, and that we are providing them with some sense of justice in our courts. Very important as well for courts, especially in the criminal setting, to engage in deterrence, both deterring specific conduct, the individual behaviors that are contrary to our fundamental notions about safety and security, people who are engaged in things that are contrary to our fundamental ideas about how a civilized society should work. How do we deter them? How do we stop them from doing those kinds of things in the future? A number of different mechanisms for doing that. Perhaps the most well-known certainly is imprisonment, but there are other mechanisms as well for deterring people individually. And beyond that, as we have spoken on this program in the past, we also have deterrence for general purposes as well. We want to send the notion, the idea to the community broadly, that by doing a particular individual prosecution of a person, perhaps of a corporation as well, that the message is going out there that if you engage as a person, as a corporation, in the similar kind of conduct, you too might be subject to criminal indictment, criminal charges. Deterrence works also in the civil area as well, that civil lawsuits that are getting attention in the media, in the community, send similar messages to deter people from engaging in bad behavior, civil, certainly criminal behavior. Deterrence, a fundamental notion, a fundamental idea that animates our courts in America. And finally, as we also know, as I mentioned in passing already, courts enhance the rule of law, right? Have given us some sense that there is a justice-based system in America, in other nations, admittedly, often imperfect, but nonetheless the kind of thing that people can look to and say, you know what, in my nation, in my country, at least we have an effort, we've got mechanisms to address the rule of law, to ensure that it's supported in the courts, and that there is a fundamental notion that the law is out there, it's passed by legislators, it is in our constitutions, and it is in fact adhered to and supported by judges, by appellate courts and others. They tell us what the law is, they enforce the law, all those things, key portions of the purposes of courts in America. When we come back right after the break, we're going to talk more about some specific invocations of those reasons for courts. Stay with us here in Morning Cannolis, sampling the news desserts of the week right here in the Shaw in Waukesha, 540 AM, 101 FM. We're back. This is Jim Santel, Morning Cannolis here in Waukesha, WAUK, The Shaw, 540 AM, 101 FM, taking your phone calls this hour and next hour as well at 844-967-2781. Honored and pleased, as always, to be here in the studio with Calvin, my producer, who will take your calls and get those on the air as we talk this morning about courts and a great number of stories from just this past week, a few of them from the previous week, that animate and describe for us what our courts, what our judicial system is all about in America. And so let's begin by revisiting a couple of stories that remain in the headlines to this hour. And then we're also going to spend the rest of this hour and the next hour talking about a lot of cases, a lot of court matters that probably have not been in the top headlines. They're out there in the media, but you have to search for them a bit more. They illustrate in ways big and small all of the important functions of courts in America, courts that ensure that the rule of law is supported, or at least there is a sense of justice, even if it's imperfectly administered, even if parties in the end feel that their positions, their claims, their allegations against others are not fully adjudicated. Nonetheless, a system that gives people an avenue for redressing those grievances and perhaps getting those differences resolved. Let's talk about a couple of stories, again, very much in the news
as late as this past evening or so. This first one comes from, of course, the review by a judge in South Florida of the Mar-a-Lago search and seizure of documents from the former president's home there and the resort area. They recall well Judge Aileen Cannon, who is a United States District Court judge in South Florida, has issued a number of rulings recently, among them recently, that she is going to appoint a special master, somebody to independent of the parties, going to review all of the documents that were taken during the course of that judicially authorized search and seizure of materials at Mar-a-Lago in early August. That process, much objected to, as you well know, by the United States Department of Justice. What did the Justice Department do? Well, they had followed the procedure that was set up by the magistrate judge when he issued and authorized the entry and the seizure of those documents in the first place. And what that procedure was, is under a privilege review process, setting up inside the Department of Justice, series of reviews by attorneys and by staff who have nothing to do with the material case, the focus of the case. Their role is simply to determine whether or not there are any materials among those that would be subject to exclusion from review, subject to exclusion from review in the investigation of whether or not the president and others had improperly taken documents, retained documents, perhaps even destroyed documents of a classified nature. This privilege review team, as the magistrate judge had set it up, was going to be and has conducted its work already in reviewing those materials to determine if there are any of those that fall in the category of attorney-client privilege. That is, things that should not be a part of the investigation and perhaps even a prosecution going forward. We know from some of the initial statements by the Department of Justice that privilege review team did in fact identify a small number of documents that they would not in fact pass on to the actual prosecutors and investigators in the case as a part of their review, and that process is pretty much done. The district court judge in this separate civil lawsuit, Judge Aileen Cannon, has said that she will in fact now appoint a special master, someone engaging in much the same kind of practice, the same kind of activity as did this privilege review team, to review these documents, causing no end of consternation inside the Department of Justice, already having undertaken this process and now finding itself very, very much stymied in being able to go forward with the investigation of whether or not there is in fact a violation of federal law in the taking and retention of these documents. She has indicated again that she is going to be appointing a special master. And so late last night, based upon her statements, her directives to the attorneys on both sides, the attorneys did in fact file a joint 8-page document. Very little about the 8-page document that really is joint in its substance, but listing a whole lot of disagreement about who this special master should be and what that person should be doing. And so just last night, we know from the Justice Department that they had proposed two former federal judges for this all-important position of now conducting this secondary review of all of these documents. The Department of Justice proposed Barbara Jones, a Clinton appointee to the Southern District of New York, who had performed a similar role in like cases involving two personal lawyers of the former president, Michael Cohen, in 2017 and Rudy Giuliani in 2021. So one of the proposed former federal judges in this list of four altogether, Barbara Jones, no longer on the federal bench, but who's done this kind of activity before, this kind of conduct before, to review documents. It's one of the two people proposed by the U.S. Department of Justice. A second one is Thomas Griffith. He was a George W. Bush appointee. He retired also from the Court of Appeals for the District of Columbia in 2020. Also a good background, an extensive background in this kind of work. Those are the two proposed nominees, if you will, the suggestions to Aileen Cannon, the district court judge, for possible selection. The defense counsel has also tendered a couple of names.
Also, a retired federal district court judge named Raymond Deary, D-E-A-R-I-E, a Reagan appointee who sat as a federal district court judge in the Eastern District of New York, once served as the United States attorney there. Again, highly qualified to do this kind of work based upon his past practice. And the fourth one, again, the second one proposed by the defense, but the fourth in this list altogether, a fellow named Paul Huck Jr., a former deputy attorney general in Florida, who served as general counsel to Charlie Crist, who was at that time its Republican governor at the time. Significantly, Mr. Huck is married to a judge. Her name is Barbara Lagoa, who President Trump appointed to the Court of Appeals for the 11th Circuit in Atlanta. That poses, I think, as most people see it, a significant conflict of interest. That 11th Circuit Appeals Court in Atlanta oversees federal courts, including those in Florida. And so an appointment of Paul Huck would almost certainly require that his spouse, Barbara Lagoa, recuse herself because of a conflict of interest that would require her to get off any cases involving the same litigation. So those are the four names that the judge in South Florida now has in front of her to decide. Needless to say, beyond the disagreements about who the special master should be, we also know that the United States Department of Justice is proposing a deadline of October 17th for the completion of this special master, this arbiter's work, and Mr. Trump's team suggesting a 90-day deadline, also indicating very different scope of that work, that focus having to do with whether the special master review all the documents, which is what the defense counsel want, or only those classified documents. Those should be sent off to the United States Department of Justice, not subject review, according to the U.S. Department of Justice. Big news coming out of South Florida. One of our many cases discussed this morning. We're going to talk about more cases coming out of the courts just this past week, in the news and out of the news, right after the break.
Still moving to me.
Moving to me.
Moving to me.
Still moving to me. Still moving to me.
And we're back. This is Jim Santel, Morning Cannolis. Thank you again for joining Calvin and me on Morning Cannolis, as we're talking this morning about courts. And right before the break, we were talking in particular about the breaking news in matters related to Mar-a-Lago and the search there, the seizure of hundreds of documents, including classified documents, right before the break, talking about the submissions by counsel for the U.S. Department of Justice that's plainly investigating whether or not there should be an indictment, whether crimes were committed, and at the other side, the attorneys for the former president, Donald Trump. Disagreement in this joint document submitted to the judge just last night, even about what the special reviewer, this auditor, if you will, should be doing, the special master should be engaging in. The government obviously saying that, well, you can take a look at all the documents that are not classified, and that anything that's unclassified, again, the United States Department of Justice begrudgingly giving those to the special master to take a look at. Mr. Trump's lawyer is asking the court to include everything in that, and potentially also to review something that the judge has also opened the door to, which is whether or not there's executive privilege in any of these documents. Kind of a curious way of doing this. All of that in understanding and underscoring the relationship between civil courts and criminal courts. Understand that this particular action in which this special master is being appointed, it's a civil case brought by the former president inside, if you will, or surrounding a criminal investigation. No one charged yet in that criminal case, but once again shows the role of courts in both of these kinds of venues, admittedly, in a case that right now is taking center stage in many, many ways, will continue to animate the airwaves and the headlines in the days ahead. Another case just from this past week that likewise partakes of both civil and criminal aspects when it comes to what judges do. This one, we go way out to New Mexico.
Mexico for. We know well, because we've talked about it a lot, that the 14th Amendment, Section 3 of the 14th Amendment, the United States Constitution, which was adopted during the Reconstruction period, basically to punish members of the Confederacy who had taken up arms against the North, against their country in the Civil War. The 14th Amendment, what does it say? It says that no person shall hold any office, civil or military, under the United States or under any state who, having previously taken an oath to support the Constitution, had then engaged in insurrection or rebellion against the same, or given aid or comfort to the enemies thereof. A lot of lawyers, if you will, creating that 14th Amendment, basically saying if you engage in insurrectionist behavior, trying to overthrow the government, you are not entitled to hold public office. And for the first time in our nation's history, just this past week, a judge, his name is Francis Matthew of the New Mexico District Court, said that the insurrection of January 6th is a predicate for finding that an individual could not, in fact, serve in a public capacity. That person is a fellow named Coy, C-O-U-Y, Griffin. He was a county commissioner in New Mexico. And just this past week, Judge Matthew found, after looking at the Coy Griffin's previous conviction in federal court in Washington, D.C., found that that was a sufficient predicate to invoke the 14th Amendment and determine that he could no longer remain in this position as county commissioner, having previously been convicted of participating in that January 6th riot at the Capitol. He was removed under the 14th Amendment by this judge, finding in a civil proceeding that this is the first public official serving in a federal official capacity to be found unfit and therefore removed from his position. We know that there have been previous attempts to do this kind of thing. In an appeals court in May, ruled that participants in an insurrection against the U.S. government, again, January 6th, could be barred from holding office. But the target of that particular case, you may recall him well, Representative Madison Cawthorn, who was out of North Carolina, had already lost his primary, so it rendered the matter essentially pretty much moot. In a related challenge, the candidacy of Representative Marjorie Taylor Greene, also Republican, this one from Georgia, a judge said that the January 6th attack on the Capitol qualified it as an insurrection, but said that there was insufficient evidence to prove that Ms. Greene engaged in it. So two instances prior to this, when the courts had taken a look at whether or not the 14th Amendment language should be invoked to bar someone from serving in a public office. This is the first time that a state court judge, invokes the 14th Amendment to do just this. So a very significant event happening in New Mexico, finding that this fellow, Coy Griffin, based upon his role specifically, he had breached the barricades outside the Capitol during that attack. That disqualifies him from engaging in further public service, other activities of his on that day. Mr. Griffin and a videographer had climbed over barricades at the Capitol, made their way into the inauguration stage in the front of the building. He spent more than an hour addressing the mob, speaking through a bullhorn, later said that he'd been attempting to lead the entire group in prayer. At that time, in the wake of his prosecution, a federal district court judge named Trevor McFadden had found that, in fact, he should be found guilty of a misdemeanor count. It was based upon that prior federal conviction, that prior finding of involvement in the insurrection, that just this past week, again, a state court judge invokes the 14th Amendment to find that Mr. Griffin can no longer serve in a state capacity based upon his federal conviction, and rules that he can no longer serve in that important role as county commissioner in New Mexico. So again, two important cases that underscore the roles of judges, what they can and cannot do, invoking the Constitution, even in a state court proceeding. Nothing wrong with that. Entirely appropriate to look at the Constitution for guidance in a state court proceeding. A civil matter to removing, but premised upon
a criminal conviction previously entered by a federal district court. Lots to consume there, I know. Lots to invite by way of comment and question. And one of those commentators, if you will, Mark is on the line with us this morning. Mark, thanks for calling in with your comments or questions or observations about courts in America, and in particular two cases we've already talked about today.
Yeah, and I'll address on both of those. I mean, as far as the federal master case, the Trump case, I think it's ridiculous the government has to jump through this hoop, because this Florida judge clearly doesn't understand the law, or she's just completely ignoring it. I mean, these are documents Donald Trump should not have had. None of those documents, classified, unclassified, or the top secret documents, should not have been at Mar-a-Lago. That the only documents the special master should be able to look at are the materials that are not
classified,
national
right? Exactly, right?
Any of the documents, right, classified, unclassified, doesn't matter. They shouldn't get to look at those at all.
Right.
As far as for the insurrectionist thing, that it also says the 14th Amendment goes on to say, or given aid or comfort to.
Right.
I mean, that what if you're a strict constructionist reading that, it does not say you have to be convicted of anything. It just says you participated in this, and if there's prima facie evidence that you participated in it, it doesn't matter that if you go with these strict constructionist interpretation, which our Supreme Court claims to do,
right,
that it doesn't say you have to be convicted of that, and also adding that given aid or comfort to the people that engaged in that activity should be a disqualifier as well.
Right, right. And that's exactly, I think, what the prior courts are wrestling with. I think, Mark, you put your finger right on the important point here. Here you've got a state court judge who can rely upon another court, a federal court that's already made that finding, if you will, right, that there has been this insurrectionist behavior. But you're absolutely right that in any sort of reasonable application and interpretation of the 14th Amendment, you don't need a conviction. You need a finding, right, just that this person, these individuals engage
right
in insurrectionist behavior. Your point is very well taken.
And to go on, that we have a candidate in the 3rd District here in Wisconsin, Van Orden, who apparently used campaign funds to fund his trip to Washington to participate in the peaceful part of the protest on January 6th, but who we don't know how close he got to the Capitol grounds, but his use of those campaign funds to fund that trip may trip up, as you will, in conflict with the rules on using campaign funds for what you can use the campaign
absolutely
for
official purposes, right? And right, that line between politics
right
and government, again, an important issue to be discussed and resolved as that particular issue goes ahead. Mark, as always, we thank you so much for your comment calling in this
Thanks,
morning.
Brother.
Absolutely. And do that again in the future. All of you call in at 844-967-2789 commenting this morning about courts as we get into other cases out there in the news. We'll do that right after the break right here on WAUK, The Show in Waukesha. We are talking all this morning about courts in America, some significant cases, headline cases up to this point that have grabbed those headlines and told us a lot about what's going on in the civil and the criminal courts of our nation. We're going to spend the rest of the morning this morning talking about other cases not quite as broadly discussed in the mainstream media, not a part of the headlines. We're going to talk next about a couple of criminal cases that underscore these concepts of deterrence, what courts do to ensure that individuals are deterred from engaging in bad behavior, things that are violative of our morals and our norms about how we should be behaving, and also, of course, the federal and state and local laws that also ensure our safety and security, and then also about general deterrence. And so let's talk about a couple of those cases. You will recall well that in early September, September 4th in particular, there was a man, now we know his name as Antonio Dupree Wright, entered into a St. Paul duplex, a residential area, came into the back door. He raised a gun. He started shooting people inside. Unfortunately, an incident that is all too common in America. This past week, a criminal complaint was issued, so we get a whole lot more detail about what exactly happened on September 4th when this melee occurred, when Mr. Wright engaged in this highly violative murderous spree. We know from the probable cause statement that was released this past week, again, supporting the charges against him, that he shot a 44-year-old woman in the head as she sat on a couch. He shot a 33-year-old in the face and shot a 42-year-old as that person tried to run away. All three of those people died in that horrific incident in St. Paul. We also know that Mr. Wright was at the time wearing a ski mask, kept shooting at others in the duplex. And as a result of that, a number of people suffered gunshot wounds. Another man who had rolled under a couch during the attack and survived. Many, many people injured as a result of this. And why is this back in the news today? Well, just this past week, authorities there, the prosecutors, released the charges against Mr. Wright, charging with three counts of murder based upon those events that I just described, three counts of attempted murder in this weekend shooting that, again, left these three people dead, two wounded, according to the criminal complaint. Significantly, our prosecutors are telling us that Mr. Wright is in custody in Chicago, where he was arrested just this past Wednesday. He's going to make his first appearance in Ramsey County District Court after he is removed, extradited from Illinois into Minnesota. It's not immediately clear if Wright had an attorney to comment on his behalf. But we also know that Wright is charged in Ramsey County with kidnapping and attempted murder from an incident 2 days prior to this particular incident in which he allegedly put a gun to the head of a man who he thought had snitched on him about his overhearing and discussing some other events. And so we have got an individual here plainly in custody, highly, highly likely will remain in custody, detained by the state courts based upon his threat to the community. Risk of flight certainly is threat to the safety and security. And the significance of this, not only in terms of bringing him to justice, enforcing the rule of law, but deterring him, right? Deterring this particular individual from engaging in this kind of horrific behavior. Everyone who engages in this kind of behavior obviously should be deterred. And more generally, also the notion of a general deterrence. The prosecutors, the courts out there, releasing this information appropriately into the public domain to let others who might engage, who might think that the use of a gun to kill and injure other people is somehow a way of remedying disputes, that behavior is not only not appropriate at the lowest level of description, but will also get you in a huge amount of trouble, will result in your criminal prosecution at the highest levels. Mr. Wright obviously faces a huge amount of time in state prison as a result of this. Deterrence, sending those messages to other people out there who engage in this kind of behavior, that they too will suffer these consequences. We hasten to add, as we always should, that individuals in America are always presumed innocent until proven guilty. Evidence here compelling in the probable cause statement, plainly to be presented in the state court in Minnesota. Deterrence as to him, to stop him from doing this in the future, presumably involving a very long prison term, if not life imprisonment, and also deterrence to other people who would think about using guns or any kind of violence to resolve disputes. Let's talk about another case, also in the criminal domain. This one goes back a year and then also reanimated this past week back in the news. This is a fellow named Robert Sylvester Kelly. We know him more generally as R. Kelly. R. Kelly, you recall well that he was convicted last year. Highly, highly advertised, highly, highly news covered event involving his sexual abuse of men, women, girls, and boys for decades, using his official position, his very public position in the music industry. At the time, in the wake of his trial, his conviction, sentenced to 30 years in prison. And R. Kelly presently serving that long term of imprisonment based upon his horrific visitation of crimes upon boys and girls and women for decades, using his position
position of notoriety, of public presence in the music industry. Why is this back in the news this past week? Well, there's a judge, a Brooklyn judge named Ann Donnelly, where this case is tried and where the jurisdiction continues, who has gotten information from the Bureau of Prisons that Mr. Kelly, during the time that he has been in prison, has already amassed about $27,828 in an inmate trust account that's locked up based upon his getting this money as a result of certain things he's done inside the prison. And Judge Connolly, as a result of her exercise of jurisdiction, continuing jurisdiction over the case, has said, you know what? That R. Kelly should not have access to those monies, and she has instead ordered that those monies be turned over to the clerk of court to be held in an interest-bearing account, first to assess and to try to satisfy a special assessment in the amount of $900, and then to go to restitution to the many, many victims, the women, the boys, the girls who were victims of R. Kelly's conduct over the many years that he victimized them sexually and otherwise abused them as a part of his criminal spree. The judge, again, Judge Connolly, making that determination that these monies, $27,828, should not be there in the account simply for the benefit of R. Kelly, but nonetheless should be given into this other account so that the court fines and special assessments ultimately going to restitution to the victims should also be used for that purpose. 55-year-old R. Kelly, as we know well, this R&B singer, is also on trial in Chicago on a separate case in which he's accused of videotaping himself having sex with children, luring them into his lure, if you will, for having sex with them, rigging his 2008 pornography trial, and otherwise affecting the course of justice. That going on even as the judge in Brooklyn ordering this past week that the monies that he has acquired that have been given to him appropriately by the Bureau of Prisons should in fact be allocated to the fines and assessments, and ultimately, as other monies go into that account, presumably, to ensure that the victims of his horrific crimes get some restitution, obviously in an attempt not to make them perfectly whole, that will never happen, but nonetheless to give them some monies that may support them in therapies and other ways that can put them back on a road to some level of decency, having been victimized so very much by R. Kelly over the years. So again, two cases in which judges are responsible for overseeing cases in the criminal setting and doing things to ensure that victims, in some cases who are alive, some cases who have perished in the conduct by those defendants, their families are the subjects of and the focuses of restitution out there. So two important cases in New York and then also in Minneapolis and Minnesota happening just this past week. Let's look to a couple of other cases, other cases involving criminal action and then also a civil action, both related in some ways to the technology and the ways in which young people and middle-aged people and old people engage in conduct in America these days. The first one, this one happens to involve a fellow named Mark Sheena, S-C-H-E-N-A. He served for many years of something called the Ariat, A-R-R-A-Y-A-I-T Corporation. It was a biomedical company, and part of his promotion was that they had supposedly invented technology to test for any disease using only a finger prick dip drop of blood. And according to the website that this corporation that Mark Sheena had promoted and been the head of, it's microarray technology. Microarray technology could test for ovarian cancer, Parkinson's disease, colon cancer, male fertility, among many other diseases and conditions. Well, Mr. Sheena was convicted this past week of 9 federal charges, including conspiracy to commit wire fraud, healthcare fraud, 3 counts of security fraud, all related to his misrepresentation about what this particular microarray technology could and could not do. Federal authorities saying that he had lied about what this technology could accomplish and committed fraud, not only with respect to potential patients out there, but also engaged in a deceptive marketing plan that falsely promoted the test's accuracy when in fact it was not at all a diagnostic test. So again, Mr. Shana this past week found guilty of engaging in all sorts of conduct involving kickbacks and bribes to recruiters and doctors, and most centrally, all sorts of fraud related to this so-called medical device, this medical operation, completely wrong, completely fraudulent. We're going to talk about yet another case just on the other side of the break. Stay with us here at WAUK Morning Cannolis, the Shaw in downtown Waukesha.
Grab your favorite morning beverage and join us for Morning Cannolis with Jim Santel.
You don't know me, but I'm your brother.
Sampling the news desserts of the week, here is your host, Jim Santel.
Welcome back to our second hour on this beautiful Saturday, September 10th morning in downtown Waukesha. This is Jim Santel. We're talking this morning about courts, the roles that they play in administering justice in America, promoting the rule of law, their various purposes, to resolve disputes, to promote safety and security, to enhance the rule of law, a sense of justice out there, to deter conduct that's violative of state statutes and federal statutes and our basic mores and understandings about how we should behave toward each other. Tell us what the law is. I mean, the Supreme Court and appellate courts do on a regular basis, taking care of victims and survivors of crime, doing all sorts of things that ensure that all the things that we do in areas of life and education, healthcare, transportation, commerce, business, all kinds of things are in fact given their due regard in the federal and state courts of our nation, and ensuring that our society has some sense of justice about it. Right before the break, we were talking about a couple of cases that are in the criminal setting, and we're going to go on to talk about many more cases this hour in both the criminal setting and in the civil setting, state cases, federal cases that underscore once again the various roles that judges and courts play. All the participants in those systems play as well, including court staff, including witnesses and members of juries, both trial juries and grand juries, prosecutors and their staff, investigators, law enforcement people, very important roles of defense attorneys in representing clients who are charged with crimes in our system, presumed innocent until proven guilty, people who work on ensuring that restitution is provided to the victims and survivors of crimes. All those folks play very important parts in our judicial system. And the cases we're talking about this morning illustrate all of that in various ways, large and small. Right before the hour break, we were talking about this fellow in California, convicted just on this past Thursday of orchestrating about a $77 million scheme involving false and fraudulent claims for all sorts of COVID-19, allergy testing, colon cancer, Parkinson's disease, all of it fraudulent. And as a result of the presentation in the court, this fellow, Mark Shannon, found guilty of 9 federal charges, facing up to 20 years in prison for conspiracy to commit health care fraud and conspiracy to commit wire fraud, as well as 20 years for each count of securities fraud, facing a lot of time in jail. Important to send those messages about deterrence.
I suspect many of you are thinking, gee, I heard this story before. And in fact, you have heard a variety of version of it, if you will. During the course of the trial, actually, the defendant compared himself to a group called Theranos, the failed blood testing startup that you may recall from the news in past times. And in that particular case, Theranos had said that it can use drops of blood which are 250,000 times smaller than the Theranos nanotainer that in the complaint by the Justice Department about the Ariat Corporation, comparing itself to Theranos, saying we're even better than Theranos. Well, we recall well that this woman named Elizabeth Holmes, the founder of Theranos, who once promised to revolutionize all sorts of healthcare through the simple blood test, and a colleague of hers named Ramesh Balwani, a former top executive of that company, were accused of similarly exaggerating the abilities of the blood testing machines of Theranos. And as a result of presentations in January of this year, Holmes and Balwani were both found guilty of counts of fraud. These latest counts with respect to Ariat, that corporation, Mark Shana, follow in the wake of that, sending the message to other folks out there who engage in this kind of medical fraud, healthcare fraud, that, again, you will be stopped. You'll be prosecuted and you'll be found guilty, presumably sentenced once again to long periods of imprisonment for that kind of conduct. We've got another case. This one not yet in the courts, but heading in that direction, but resulting in a resolution of it, an agreement among many states and a particular corporation called Juul Labs, J-U-U-L Labs. It's been fighting for its survival in this country, and based upon an agreement reached this past Tuesday, Juul Labs agreed to pay $438.5 million to settle an investigation by a number of states, including Wisconsin, to settle an investigation by many of these states over marketing and sales of what? Selling to teenagers vaping devices and promoting the vaping crisis. Specifically, a multi-state investigation had found that this company, Juul Labs, found that the company appealed to young people by hiring young models in their promotion, their advertisements. They used social media to court teenagers and they gave out free samples of their products. The investigation, again, conducted by many, many states, revealed that this company, Juul Labs, had found what they called a porous age verification system for its products, and that 45% of its Twitter followers were between the ages of 13 and 17. Among other things, one of the attorneys general in one of the states that had been pursuing this investigation of Juul Labs said the company's strategy of selling flavors like mango and creme brulee appealed to youth, as did sort of the sleek design of its devices that were easy to conceal in a backpack or in a pocket. One of the terms of the settlement that was announced this past week requires that the banned company no longer depicts anyone under the age of 35 in its marketing images as a part, again, of this settlement overall. The agreement, for what it's worth, among the Juul Labs and many of these states, including Wisconsin, does not resolve all of the company's legal battles. There are still cases in North Carolina and Washington, Louisiana, Arizona, 9 similar cases out there. Major lawsuits also filed by New York and California, among those still pending, and about 3,600 cases, 3,600 lawsuits by individuals, school districts, and local governments, many of those consolidated, all of those still wending their way through a California court. We know based upon presentations in the public media generally, and certainly a part of this investigation, that e-cigarette use among teenagers, although it's fallen in recent years, has provided a whole new source of great health concern among some of our youngest residents. In March, a
survey by the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention showed that nearly 8%, or about 2 million students, reported using e-cigarettes within the past 30 days. And again, this company appealing through its candy flavors and its mechanisms, appealing to a youthful audience, that kind of thing. The focus of this investigation, Juul settling this multi-state youth vaping inquiry for $438.5 million. No doubt going to be presented in court to establish its enforcement. The cases in many, many states around the country, including, as I said, Wisconsin, Wyoming, New Jersey, North Dakota, Mississippi, Maryland, Indiana, Connecticut, many, many states out there partaking in this settlement. And again, presumably, those monies doing what? Ultimately going into the coffers to address the problems related to youth vaping, e-cigarettes that we know, based upon the CDC reports and other reporting about the impact that vaping has had upon our most youthful residents and citizens of our nation. And so again, an instance where anticipating a court approval for this huge, admittedly still partial settlement as to Juul Labs fighting for its survival these days in the courts and against all these other investigations, presumably at some point bringing it probably to a close as a viable operation. Once again, underscoring, however, the role that courts play, that investigations play. This one, civil in nature, not criminal in nature, but resulting in monies that can help people and ensure that their particular damages, the things that they have suffered as a result of the conduct of this corporation, do not go unaddressed, just the opposite. So we'll look forward to seeing what happens to those monies and the investigations as those go forward in other areas. We've got a couple of other important lawsuits in the civil area that also underscore the role that courts play. This one, very interesting. It's a First Amendment case. A First Amendment, again, under the basic principles of free speech and the capacity to protest and to speak publicly. It comes out of Oberlin College. Oberlin College in Ohio, a college that's known for a very, very liberal arts college. The particular case here is that this past week, Oberlin agrees that it's going to pay $36.59 million to a local bakery right across the street from the campus that said it had been defamed and falsely accused of racism after a worker caught a black student shoplifting there a couple of years ago. How does this develop, and how does this become a First Amendment case? How is it that Oberlin, this college in Ohio, is now paying defamation damages to a local bakery called Gibson's Bakery that had maintained that the college had falsely accused it of racism? The case hinged on whether Oberlin officials had defamed the bakery by supporting students who accused it of racial profiling, and the verdict, essentially finding that the officials had done so, may make some other colleges and universities around the country give some thought to joining student causes. What had happened in particular here was that way back in a couple of years ago, a young man named Alan Gibson, a son and grandson of the owners, who is white, had chased a student out of the store, where two of his friends, students at Oberlin, had joined in the scuffle out on the street. The students who were engaged in this behavior inside the store pled guilty to various charges, and the altercation led to days of protest after that. Several hundred students gathered in front of the bakery, accused it having racially profiled its customers, according to some of the court filings. The lawsuit that was filed by Gibson's contended that Oberlin, the university, the college itself, had defamed the bakery when the dean of the students and other members of the administration took sides in that dispute by attending the protests where filers had distributed documents and suggested that this bakery was in fact engaged in racist behaviors in responding to the misconduct of these students inside the store. And as a result of a three-judge panel in the Ohio Court of Appeals confirming the jury's finding, that Oberlin was in fact liable for libel, intentional infliction of emotional distress. That case now standing is a First Amendment case that established the right of this store to advance its own First Amendment rights to not be subject to defamation. We'll talk more about that right after the break and give you some more insight into that and some other cases here on Morning Cannolis. And we're back here on Morning Cannolis. This is Jim Santel talking with you today about the courts and various ways in which our civil courts, our criminal courts, administer justice in America. And right before the break, we were talking about this matter out of Oberlin College in Ohio just this past week, when in the wake of a trial, a First Amendment trial, Oberlin College agrees to pay about $37 million to a local bakery. Right before the break, I was describing a three-judge panel in the Ohio Court of Appeals that had confirmed the jury's finding after a six-week trial that Oberlin was in fact liable for libel, intentional infliction of emotional distress, and intentional interference with a business relationship, that it had effectively, if you will, defamed the business by siding with the protesters. And the original jury award was even higher at about $44 million. Significantly. The reason why this case is important is that in its ruling, the Court of Appeals, again, reviewing the lower court administration of justice and the judgment at that level, the Court of Appeals agreed that the students had a right to protest, But the court said that the flyer and some related student senate resolutions, which said that the store had a history of racial profiling, were not constitutionally protected opinions, not constitutionally protected under the First Amendment. And as a result, the bakery entitled to damages. The underlying event, once again, was way back in November 2016. A student had tried to buy a bottle of wine with a fake ID, was also engaged in shoplifting two more bottles, hiding them under his coat. Again, as I said before the break, the result of that conduct inside the store spills out into the street, scuffle happens, and as a result of that, protests ensue, alleging that the bakery is in fact racist in the way that it responded to this behavior. Turns out that the courts find that Oberlin, in engaging with the students who do have a right to protest and to speak their minds about what they believe is true and should be a part of our national discussion, but Oberlin, in endorsing and embracing what the students and other protesters had said, found, if you will, liable for damages, not criminally responsible, but liable for damages under the First Amendment for the things that were said inappropriately, inaccurately about Gibson's Bakery in Ohio. Again, a big case coming out of Oberlin College, First Amendments, rights to protest, and the damages that even a small company can in fact get if in fact a larger entity like Oberlin College engages in behavior that is contrary to law. Let's talk about a couple of other cases. This one very much in your public recollection. You recall a number of years ago, about 18 months or so ago, the Champlain Towers South came crashing down in Florida. You recall this very well in Miami. There's a judge named Michael Hansman, much in the news this week, who is responsible for handling all of the cases that came out of the Surfside condos, victims, families, lawsuits, and their claims to damages. So a little over a year after the Champlain Towers South fell with great notoriety. We all remember the pictures well, the images of this residential unit coming down, the losses of life, this deadly collapse on this beachfront condominium near Surfside, Florida. Call that all very well. We have a judge, and this is a good news story out of a horrific event. A judge who said, you know what, this is not going to be a case where the victim families have to wait years and years and years to get restitution, to get the things that they should get, that will attempt, again, imperfectly, to put them back in a place where they can continue with their lives. And so just this past week, after 5 weeks of lengthy and emotional hearings in court, court, out of court meetings, discussions among the lawyers and among people involved in the court system. The court issued letters late August informing survivors and their victim families about how much they would receive in damages from a settlement of more than $1 billion with insurance companies. That settlement also involved the developers of an adjacent building and some other defendants who were likewise responsible for the falling apart, the collapse of this beachfront condominium about 15 or so months ago. Individual awards, according to what the court released in its letters, range from $50,000 for some post-traumatic stress disorder claims to more than $30 million for some wrongful death claims. And all of those handled by Judge Hansman, this fellow named Michael Hansman, who was describing what he did this past week. And again, the reason for this story is not only to begin to talk about the resolution of this horrific event in the courts, outside of the courts, but noting that out of this tragedy, a judge taking it under his wing, taking responsibility for ensuring that justice is not delayed and therefore denied, as is so often the case. Moving this along to ensure that it was not years and years before the victim survivors, the families of victims, would get some compensation for this catastrophic event. So in one of his first unorthodox moves to persuade the surviving members of the Towers South County Association, the judge appointed Michael Goldberg, a lawyer, who was an independent party known as Receiver, to handle their claims. And he brought them together to ensure that all the complaints and all the claims could be combined into one big lawsuit, one kind of colossal understanding of who is claiming what, so we can see them sort of all in one file, if you will. And absent that, there would have been dozens of separate lawsuits, very, very likely, in this entire process. And so Judge Hansman brought that method, brought that process together to ensure, if you will, a consolidation under the auspices, under the direction of this fellow he appointed, Michael Goldberg, to provide independent receiver responsibilities and duties. He also dealt with the conflicts between the victims' families, many of them who had plainly suffered terribly, and some of the survivors who had lost property. He persuaded another fellow named Bruce Greer, a mediator also known well in the area, to try to resolve those conflicts over how much money each group deserved to receive. And in February of this year, the condo unit owners agreed to split about $83 million from the land sale and from Champlain Towers South insurers, a total that later went up to about $96 million, and paid them for the appraised value of their units. Again, trying to figure out what the total amount of loss is and ensuring that the arithmetic in all of this makes some sense. $1 billion shared among families who lost loved ones in the condo collapse. That sum, again, from developers and engineering consultants and security companies whom the law firms had identified as possibly at fault for the disaster, as well as their insurers. Again, a good news result in the wake of a terrible, terrible tragedy. The Surfside case, plainly used as a model for other cases, this could minimize, if not eliminate, the pain and the suffering, as one of the victim survivors has said. Right after the break, we're going to talk about yet more cases, good news cases and tragic cases in and out of our courts here in the United States of America at WAUK here in Waukesha, the Shaw, 540 AM, 101 FM. We're back once again this morning talking about courts, about justice in America, reviewing a great number of cases, not so much in the mainstream media this past week, that nonetheless underscore the kinds of things that judges and juries and prosecutors and defense counsel, civil litigants, victim witness specialists, other staff in the courts do on a regular basis to administer justice and ensure that there is some sense,
perhaps not a perfect sense of the rule of law being promoted and administered in the United States of America. Right before the break, we talked about these two civil cases, this one matter just breaking yesterday, the day before, involving Oberlin College and its requirement now to pay libel damages to a bakery based upon the college's embracing of some inaccurate statements about its allegedly about the bakery's allegedly racist behavior in connection with some student conduct there. A First Amendment case that kind of tested the limits of public advocacy and public speech and the ways in which a university can and cannot run afoul of the libel laws. And again, plainly a victory for the small bakery there. Also, we were talking about this matter coming out of South Florida, which you recall well, the destruction of the Surfside condo there at Champlain Towers South. This wonderful work by a district court judge there and some of the folks he appointed to administer funds to figure out how much monies the various parties should be paid in compensation. Certainly not perfect, certainly not complete, to try to make the victims and the survivors of that horrific event somewhat more commensurate with their losses, and to restore them to some sense of normalcy, if you will, as they go forward in their lives. Both of those civil cases. Let's go back on the criminal side of things and talk about a very significant case involving a former security officer at Uber, of all places. His name is Joe Sullivan. Back in 2017, Mr. Sullivan was fired by Uber, and he was accused at that time of mishandling a security incident the year before. And at that time, we weren't quite certain what that was all about, but we know now from a trial just underway this past week based upon a criminal complaint, criminal charges brought against Joe Sullivan, that in 2016, Sullivan learned that hackers had secured access to the personal data of about 600,000 Uber drivers, and in addition, some personal information associated with about 57 million riders and drivers. So someone hacks in and gets a lot of information from the Uber files, the Uber insights into who these folks are, personal information, drivers and riders both. And the prosecution in this case accused Mr. Sullivan of directing those responsible to the company's bug bounty program that Uber, apparently like many other companies, had set up as a financial incentive for third parties to report its security vulnerabilities. Lots of disagreement about whether or not this kind of thing should be charged. As a result of this, Uber ultimately paid the hackers, two men in their 20s, $100,000 in Bitcoin and had them sign non-disclosure agreements, according to the criminal complaint. Uber did not disclose this incident to the public at the time, nor did it inform the Federal Trade Commission, which was investigating the company for its privacy and some of its security practices as well. So lots of issues here. Prosecutors had accused Mr. Sullivan of obstructing justice and concealing a felony for not disclosing the breach or revealing it to the FTC. The spokesman for the defendant said he could not discuss the case based upon the fact that the trial is underway. And Uber, likewise, declining to comment, prompting a lot of discussion about whether this is a criminal matter, whether this is a civil matter, whether it should be in the courts at all. But we know going forward that Mr. Sullivan is now facing criminal charges for his handling of this 2016 security breach in a way that the prosecutors say is violative of the criminal law. It has divided the security industry on whether or not this is the kind of thing that the courts should be doing, criminal courts, civil courts, and plainly as the verdict is heard down the road, more discussion about Joe Sullivan and the role that a security executive, a security official plays in ensuring the security of a company and significantly here, the requirement to disclose that to the FTC, to other people who should know about it. We'll watch that case. Joe Sullivan, this ex-Uber executive, now in trial. Another criminal matter heading way back to Washington, D.C. once again, to the January 6th matter, the insurrection there, the riot at the Capitol. We know about the various prosecutions that have been undertaken to this time. We know that about 870 people
from, frankly, about 50 states throughout the union been arrested for crimes that are related to that January 16th riot, that insurrection at the Capitol, attempting to stop the counting of electoral votes that day. We know that more than 265 people have been charged. Again, criminal charges. These are not civil charges. All in the federal district courts in the District of Columbia. Various charges with assaulting or impeding law enforcement, and all sorts of charges that are bringing these people into court in the federal criminal courts, misdemeanors and felonies alike. Many members of the Proud Boys, one of these insurrectionist groups, have been charged with crimes for actions that they took on January 6th, including some of the top leaders. And we've talked about that before. Some of those top leaders charged with seditious conspiracy, not yet going to trial, but those trials also to be had in the District of Columbia in the federal trial courts there. Well, this past week, we know, based upon court documents released, that two individuals, one fellow named Nicholas Ox, O-C-H-S, who is the founder of the Proud Boys Hawaii chapter and a senior leadership there, was charged with his conduct, with his involvement in the January 6th event. A second Nicholas, a fellow named Nicholas DiCarlo, also charged with his involvement on events on that day, the day before the attack happened, and their activities on that day. The two men, according to the charges released just this past week, attended former President Trump's rally at the Ellipse, and that, as you know, preceded the riot. And then these two, Ox and DiCarlo, allegedly joined others who were illegally on the Capitol grounds that day. They threw smoke bombs at police who were attempting to hold the rioters back. They climbed the stairs to the Upper West Terrace and illegally entered the building and stayed there for about 40 minutes. They filmed themselves smoking cigarettes while in the building. DiCarlo, Nicholas DiCarlo, the second of these two defendants, wrote "Murder the Media" with a marker on a door of the Capitol, which Ox had recorded. They then went, according to the criminal complaint, went through the U.S. Capitol with a duffel bag near the door and took with a pair of handcuffs, plastic handcuffs, likewise in the Capitol. Both of those Proud Boys found pled guilty this past week to obstruction of official proceedings, which is also the charge of many of those others, of hundreds of people, likewise facing prosecution for the January 6th event. Both those Proud Boys pled guilty this past week to obstruction of an official proceeding, both facing large times in prison, up to 20 years in jail for those counts, plainly going to be sentenced down the road on December 9th of this year. Ox was arrested the day after the insurrection. DiCarlo arrested later that month, both to be sentenced now on December 9th for the federal crimes that they pled guilty to this past week. An indication of the continuing work of the Department of Justice when it comes to addressing these folks who quite literally were responsible for the assault on the Capitol. As we know well, the United States Department of Justice also looking at a higher tier, the Proud Boys, the Three Percenters, others who were involved in supervising and organizing on social media and other ways, people coming to the Capitol in the days before January 6th. And then we also know, very much a part of our national news coverage, that people at the highest levels of government, perhaps including the former president himself, senior aides at the time, also the focus of a grand jury investigation into what they knew. What did they do to coordinate, if anything? What did they do to administer and otherwise organize conduct that resulted in people not only at the Ellipse, which is entirely protected by the First Amendment and the ability to assemble and to protest, but not to incite violence and not to engage in violence, which is what many of these charges are all about. The questions before the federal grand juries that are investigating this, focusing on people who now were responsible for sending out messages, calling people to Washington, D.C., inciting them, enticing them to Washington, D.C., to engage in these kind kind of violent behaviors. We don't know yet what's going to come of those prosecutions, but we know that based upon these most recent pleas of guilty, that the prosecutions of all the people, virtually all the people involved in that conduct, continue through the U.S. Department of Justice as a part of this process. We're going to come back right after the break and talk about a few more cases in the last moments of our time together. Courts in America, that's the subject this morning on Morning Cannolis. Join us as always with your calls and questions at 844-967-2789. We're back for our final moments here on a Saturday morning. Thank you so much for joining me this morning as we're talking about courts. We're going to spend the last minutes here talking about two more cases that, along with all the other things we've talked about this morning, illustrate the breadth, the scope of the kinds of things that courts in America undertake to pursue on behalf of justice and promoting the rule of law, civil cases, criminal cases, federal cases, state cases, even local cases, the roles that all these courts play in administering justice and ensuring that we've got a sense of rule of law in our nation, even if it is, as I have said repeatedly, imperfect and sometimes incomplete. Nonetheless, that's what our courts are designed to do, all these various missions out there. Two more cases, one of them right here in Wisconsin, and then finally finishing up this hour with where we began, going back to Washington, D.C., and the former president in a lawsuit that he brought. He brought a number of weeks, months ago against Hillary Clinton. Let's start with a local lawsuit here. This case involves a local Racine man in Wisconsin. His name is Harry Waite. He was a leader of a Racine County-based group known as HOT Government, H-O-T Government. That group promotes false claims of voter fraud in the 2020 election. We know that there was very little, if any, voter fraud in that election. He was charged this past week with two counts of election fraud and two counts of unauthorized use of an individual's personal identifying information. Where does that come from? What is the predicate for this? Well, again, you may recall this story, which, again, surfacing this past week as charges are brought against him. Mr. Waite, Harry Waite, posed as Assembly Speaker Robin Voss and Racine Mayor Corey Mason, requesting their ballots in order to show violations of the law are possible. That, according to Harry Waite, the reasons he gave for trying to do that. Well, it turns out that indeed is election fraud in and of itself. Two counts of election fraud, two counts of unauthorized use of an individual's personal identifying information. Mr. Waite, this past week, right before the court hearing, compared himself to some of the founding fathers in his work to try to expose this voter fraud, which once again did not exist, and also said that he was doing this as a way of underscoring the voter fraud that was out there, that the founders of our nation would be proud of him for disclosing this, for bringing this to the attention of Americans, when in fact none of this is real. Interestingly, significantly, the judge before whom Mr. Waite appeared blocked him, told him to stop talking to reporters again about his case, even as he was comparing his actions in the public domain to those of our founding fathers, again, presumed innocent until proven guilty, alleging that he was engaged in civil disobedience as was in his conduct. But along the way, gathering these counts of election fraud, two counts of unauthorized use of an individual's personal identifying information, Mr. Waite now a defendant in the criminal justice system, alleging that his conduct was premised upon civil disobedience in an attempt to show voter fraud that was out there. Our final case this morning, again, as we talk about courts generally. You may recall a number of months ago, back in March, that former President Trump had filed a lawsuit against Hillary Clinton and various other top officials in the government, some of her staff, some top FBI officials as well. He maintained that they had inappropriately, inaccurately described the an association with his campaign, concocting a Russian investigation that had shadowed much of his administration, and basically alleging that Hillary Clinton and the FBI got together, conspired to come up with this story about how the Trump campaign had engaged with the Russians to undermine the election at that time, and that as a result of that, he had suffered damages. This is, again, a civil lawsuit in the federal district court. A federal district court judge this past week dismissed that case in some language that I think is also very instructive, as are the decisions of all these other judges. This is a district judge named Donald Middlebrooks. He said in a very sharply worded ruling just this past Thursday that the former president's lawsuit, again, filed in March, alleging that Hillary Clinton, FBI officials, other staff members had engaged in this effort to try to besmirch the former president's status, destroy his reputation by suggesting that there was a connection to Russia in this, by establishing and pursuing this investigation that had dogged him through much of his, at least the initial portion of his administration. So Middlebrooks, this judge this past week, says no. This case must be dismissed. He says it contains, in his words, glaring structural deficiencies, and that many, as he said, many of the characterizations events are simply implausible. Judge Middlebrooks goes on to say that Trump had sued to correct an actual legal harm, dismissing that idea, however, saying that instead of doing that, which is what normal litigants do in a civil lawsuit, he's seeking to flaunt, these again the judge's words in his order dismissing this case, seeking to flaunt a 200-page political manifesto outlining his grievances against those that have opposed him. This court is not the appropriate forum, Judge Middlebrooks said. As I indicated, the lawsuit had named Clinton as a defendant, some FBI officials, including Director James Comey, others involved in the investigation into whether or not the Trump 2016 presidential campaign had coordinated with Russia to sway the outcome of the election. Middlebrooks went on to write, "What the amended complaint lacks in substance and legal support, it seeks to substitute with length, hyperbole, and settling of scores and grievances." Very strong language by the judge. A little bit more of that language. He called the complaint style one of shotgun pleading and a waste of judicial resources. He said this, as I've already alluded, plaintiffs, that is the former president, his pleading contains glaring structural deficiencies of the sort we all already made reference to. I would be remiss to not expound upon these further before I set out to evaluate the substantive viability of plaintiff's claims. Plaintiff's amended complaint is a quintessential shotgun pleading, and courts in the 11th Circuit, which is where this district court sits, have little tolerance for shotgun pleadings. That is no small language, not inconsequential language being offered by this district court judge. He would describe this as a fundraising tool, a press release. And he said more troubling than the verbosity of the Trump filing were that the claims presented in the amended complaint are not warranted under existing law. Middlebrooks took several cues from Trump's lawyers about what the law actually says. He's basically instructing them. He accused them of ignoring the Supreme Court's rulings about wire fraud, failing to account for the Supreme Court's requirement that obstruction of justice allegations must relate to an actual judicial proceeding, and of otherwise making implausible arguments that according to the judge, lack any specific allegations that might provide factual support for the conclusions released. He notes that the malicious prosecution claims were rubbish. Plaintiff was never prosecuted, this judge goes on to say. A long, long order describing all of this and finishing up with a strong indictment of his own, that is, a judge, about what the former president did here through his lawyers, saying that Trump's lawyers were mischaracterizing their own cited materials, a frequent refrain from the judge. If a party, he said, chooses to include such references, it is expected that they be presented in good faith and with evidentiary support Unfortunately, he said, that is not the case here. I went to page 96 of the Inspector General's report looking for some support for plaintiff's conclusory and argumentative statement, but found none, citing the precise page referenced by the Trump lawyers. Plaintiff and his lawyers are, of course, free to reject the conclusion of the Inspector General, but they cannot misrepresent it in a pleading. A really, really stunning, stunning reversal of the complaint, turning it back, saying that it must, in fact, be dismissed. The judge schooling, as I said, the Trump's lawyers on whether or not several of the defendants were acting also in the scope of their employment, an issue that was hotly litigated in previous motions, speaking to the press about public policy concerns, falls from the scope of the duties of members of Congress, the judge noted. And for that reason, the complaint and the complaining party here, President Trump, all of his allegations must fall. Finally, the judge included a sampling of Trump's tweets, the president's tweets in the order. He says this, plaintiff's tweets appear to fall in the category of information that this circuit has recognized as appropriate for taking judicial notice. Facts that are not subject to reasonable dispute from sources whose accuracy cannot reasonably be questioned. I note, though, the judge goes on to say, that even without plaintiff's tweets, the allegations of plaintiff's amended complaint demonstrate that plaintiff was aware of the basis of his claims since at least 2017. Although the tweets provide further support, they are not essential to my ruling on the RICO statute of limitations. And he ends where he begins, that is saying that this RICO lawsuit alleging this huge conspiracy among Hillary Clinton and members of the FBI and Jim Comey simply is not supported by anything in the complaint. It is sprawling, he said. It is significant, but not at all a basis for the lawsuit dismissed today by a federal district court judge. And that concludes. That concludes this broad analysis, this broad scope review of many different cases, civil and criminal, in just this past week, underscoring the important roles that courts play, that judges play. I thank you so much for tuning in, for listening to this discussion. And tune in next week when we'll once again be talking about law and government and the aspiration for justice.